about an hour. You may not know this, he's a bit verbal. And then we go out. I went out on the balcony, out on his back patio, and you read the script alone. He'll come and check on you about halfway, how you're doing. And that's kind of helpful. And I went, I think I was early because the script looked pretty crisp, and then I got called back about, I don't know, 6 weeks later. And I come back and it's all like spaghetti stained and coffee, dog ears. You know that we've all been at it.
Everyone's come in, well, it's interesting because he wants to have this one-on-one immediate reaction, and he's constantly checking on you're laughing at the right spot. But you read the whole thing there, you have that experience, and then you discuss your initial reaction about the screenplay and the character. So he really loves that. He loves speaking to actors and people in the industry about their take on what he's done, because he's a writer-director. He wants that feedback.
And Billy, you didn't know who QT was when you first met him, right?
No. No, I didn't. I was nine. I was freshly nine. No idea when Tarnentino was.
So how did you get in this movie at freshly nine?
Right young age of nine. Okay, well, it seemed like a pretty cool script that I got the call saying, so I got the script and bulked some of it, the audition part, which was 21 pages of a lot of dialogue. And I took it home and I looked at it and it was really pretty. And so I had the first audition. It was really, really fun. It was really like no other audition you could really hope for. It was just so, he seemed like he's known you for a while. Hey, it treats you like a good friend, like a good colleague, that what. And so we had so much fun, we laughed together, and I walked out feeling happy. I was genuinely excited. And I got a call back, and then after that, equally as fun, he called me and my mom to his office, and we went in, and he told me that he would like me to play the part. And of course I said yeah, like it was so fun. It seemed like such a great set to be on. So it was, it really was.
And Margaret, you auditioned and then you took a trip to what, Panama? And that's when you get the call to come on back to read your
practice. Yeah. It was kind of a weird thing though. It was funny, my dad was in Panama and he was trying to convince me to come visit him, and I was just the unemployed person, and we'll book a ticket to Panama and you'll get a Quinten Tarantino movie. And he was just kind of saying like the best director he could think of, and kind of by the logic that if you make plans like it's the way, you can't do the vacation thing. So I did that, and then I did get a Quinten Tarantino.
And Mike, you were an actor here in LA, you moved away, and this sort of brought you back. Can you tell us that story?
Yeah, so I spent about 8 years here in LA, did fine, did okay, then we had our second kid, and we wanted to get back home, and I opened a martial arts school, and I started doing that. I started working out of Chicago, and one day I'm teaching class, my Apple phone starts ringing, I take a call, and the next day I'm auditioning Thomas, and then 2 weeks later I'm back with QT, and then 2 weeks later I'm supposed to do a chemistry read, which I'm assuming is with Brad, and then I walk in and there's Burt Reynolds at everybody at the table, and that was my final audition. So I just remember everybody at that table, I'll never forget it, and I think I was the only person at that table that had not been booked on the show. So that was a nerve-wracking but exciting moment. I just kept remembering like page 53, because that was
Leo, how did you find Quinten talks a lot about how Rick and Cliff are based on many
first off, Quinten is the ultimate cinephile. There are a handful of filmmakers that are true cinephiles, like put them up on Jeopardy type movies. Ask them anything about cinema history and they'll come up with the answer or close to it. And what I discovered, you know, he's not only a cinephile, but he almost has this sort of cultural knowledge about that time period, but also the music of that time period and television. And he started giving me, you know, episodes of every type of Western from the 60s you could ever imagine. A lot of movies, B and cult film. Oh, that's the other thing as a cinephile about B films and that no one's ever heard of. Kung Fu films, all of them. And so I started watching a lot of television. Television from the 60s and a lot of B films that I'd never seen before, and introduced me to this sort of whole culture of actors in the 60s and that time period that never quite made that transition with guys like, you know, Eddie Burns, Ralph Meeker, Ty Harden. And it kind of just threw and inundated me with this time period. You know, I watched a lot of classic films from that era. I watched a lot of movies, but it was a great immersive experience for me because I felt like he was trying to see what type of actor I was going to respond to. And we, you know, after floating through at least a dozen of them, this Ralph Meeker became the actor that I sort of honed in on because I saw that he never quite made, he did some movies afterwards, but he never quite made that step in his career, but I felt this amazing pathos in his performances, and I was like, well, Rick has to have the ability to be a good actor. You know, he meets, you know, Miss Butter's character, who's like this young Meryl Streep. Awful, just like Julia was before we even started, and she's a consummate an actress. And this sort of re-inspires and reawakens this sort of hunger in Rick to, well, gosh, maybe I should kind of study my craft and learn my lines, and not learn my lines, but learn my craft and really give it some focus rather than perpetually feeling sorry for myself.
And then you go in that trailer and you have this a meltdown, a breakdown. I've heard it described in many different ways. That's going to be an iconic meltdown of cinema.
Thank you.
And it was your idea, was it improvised? Tell me, how does that happen?
Well,
that's a good improv.
It was in the navigation of this character that he wrote, which I felt like was this semblance of a time period, just to make it quick. You know, Rick lives within the context of being on a movie set. He is an actor on a semi-good television show, and he's the new sort of, he's the old leading man that is now the heavy that's getting beaten up by the new leading man. And I felt like there just needed to be a turning point rather than just living within this Western of, you know, him really screwing up royally and having this sort of coming to Jesus moment of his psyche. And that led to that improvised sequence in the trailer, because after we did that, we were going to try two different ways. And then Quinn's like, well, we have to have you freak out the trailer afterwards and then come back like a Western, walking down the Western set, a Western within a Western, and shoot out, which is your acting scene, and you wouldn't shoot out. So that's a
Brad, so who did you find that you, you know, who is the actor that Quinn turned you on to, or the stuntman?
Well, funny enough, I came to his house with a DVD in my pocket, and he had me come to his house with a film he had already put on the screen that he was going to screen that night for us. And it was Billy Jack. Just as kind of a starting point of a place to spring from. But we had talked a lot about the relationships, especially then, the stuntman act relationship. They invented much more, they had much more authorship over the stunts themselves. And there's been some classic pairings like Steve McQueen, Buddy Hinds, and Burt Reynolds, and Hal Needham were quite infamous. And then I think lastly, really, I mean, I'd have to sit back and watch, you know? I mean, first of all, it was pretty automatic for Leo and I, just having relied on friends like this we had so many decades, that, you know, keep you calm, keep you balanced. And they're very, they mean everything to me. So there was a natural starting point there as well. And then on top of it, you know, Rick's dealing with his problem. Pussycat's a free spirit. And Cato's coming at me. And Dakota, Squeaky, was like, she was not backing down. And then there was Bruce Dern, which I still not sure what he was doing. She was different. And he just wanted to take notes afterwards. But so I had the luxury of being able to bounce off of all this, and it really is a collaborative sport.
So why did it take Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio this many years to find the screen?
There was a restraining order. I don't want to talk about it. It's water on the bridge now. We worked it out.
Things are good. Things are great. what's so interesting about the characters that he created, we've used this. You have to understand,
he's not hiding outside his house. In
We do these publicity tours, so we say this term a lot. Sort of two sides of the same coin, isn't it? You know, it's like, and we knew, you know, he had to kind of, it was an amazing setup, and the fact that, you know, we both got to do this together, and we'll, you know, draw from our own experiences, especially in this industry, in these types of relationships. Like Brad said, it was kind of automatic, like we walked up on set and kind of knew who these guys were. And I've said this many times, but you know, on the first day, Brad said to me, "Damn, you're Rick fucking Dalton," as I'm walking on set. That line kind of like just resonated with me, because that is the relationship. He's hungover, he's feeling sorry for himself, suffering this, you know, total breakdown, realizing that his career is, you know, withering away. He's got that guy that's gonna say, "Hey, cheer up, man. You're a working actor. You're Rick fucking Dalton." And that really clicked. Our relationship just clicked on day one with that one. And that was improvised by him, and I used it again.
And then you could go home and fix your antenna.
Right.
Junior, what was it like whispering to Leonardo DiCaprio, "That's the best actor"?
He's just so great that it wasn't hard for it to come out. It was an easy line, but it wasn't easy at the same time. It was basically just truth in dialogue.
Wow. You obviously play a dancing girl. I know you did some research. Said that you were a little hesitant to have Bruce Lee lose a fight.
He didn't lose. All right. Brad and I will settle things later. Between Kato and Kato, it was a tie. So, yeah, no, it was fun. That was probably the most fun I've ever had as a professional actor. That week was so much fun. It was a
and humbling when I realized Mike had to slow down. He had to slow down as much as.
That was all done in one.
I know.
It was all done in one, right?
So
I wasn't there that day. So
Sunday, I don't know if you remember this, Brad, the Sunday before we shot, it was a Tuesday, I'll never forget. The Sunday we're doing our final stunt rehearsal. And we're all good and we're about to leave, and Quinten pulls me aside. He says, Mike, the way that we're gonna shoot this scene, I have a certain idea of how we're gonna do it, it's gonna be one take. And it's all on you to do it so that I can shoot it the way I want to. And he said, so you don't screw it up. And I looked at him and I like did like a big gulp, and I said, you hired the right guy, Mr. Tarnentino.
I know, he's so curious, he told me that. But wait, and I said, okay, yeah, but you can, you know, there's ways to cheat it. You can quit pan, and then you could cut two different takes together, right? He goes, no, that's cheating. So that's why we're
tell me about, and this is open to anyone, Quinn as a director, is he a lot of takes? Is it a lot of improvising? Or is it sort of, he knows what he wants, gets it?
How would you describe it? I would say, yeah, there can be a lot of takes at times. I think that, you know, he, as a writer-director, and a great writer-director, would be very attached to their dialogue, especially great Tarantino dialogue. So a lot of people kind of look at it like Shakespeare, and sometimes when you don't get the punctuations and the rhythm of the line, they'll point that out. But, you know, to contradict that, he also allows these moments of improvisation where he just lets the scene go. Things sort of happen. And so it's a combination of both, but he's incredible with that.
Yeah,
it's really incredible. He really is. Really gives you ownership.
Having so much fun itself, it's pretty infectious.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of like group
morale. He's incredibly enthusiastic about being able to make movies. He loves movies. He's, you know,
and it's infectious.
And he literally is on set and, like, has a, you know, let's do one more take. And the whole crew chants, why? Because we love making movies. It's this great joy that he has to be on set to be a working director. It's a great message.
Now, you guys have worked with him before, but you haven't. Did you know that there's this chance or do?
I just completely like one.
Spirit and energy,
but also it's like his attention to detail, to smaller characters, to create a sort of ecosystem on set. And I feel like, you know, he definitely has plans for specific but he, you know, like I remember during Django Unchained, there were, you know, we were at Candyland Ranch and just endless days of sort of shooting atmosphere and people until he hones in on what the scene is about, you know, and you can often see that in the directing sometimes. It's like all these different flavors and these characters coexisting, but then he zooms in on what he wants that scene to be about. It's, you know, I think, I don't know specifically, but I've heard him say that oftentimes he knows what he wants the scene to project, but he kind of throws away his shot list. Mm-hmm. He wants to see what the actors give him. What life the scene sort of, you know,
comes out and then shoots.
Yeah, he's nimble that way, and even the last fight scene, he didn't. The Manson gang. There was some of the scripted, you know, some of the big hits that caught him in the forehead. But he was building this bit by bit. Like he just started out. We shot that in sequence, and he was in molding it and honing it as we went. And he was setting the shots. You know, we got that one, and then what's going to be the next one? So for me, in my experience, that takes great confidence, a great belief in touch.
And he makes everyone check their cell phones, right?
Oh, God, yeah.
I said this before, but this whole experience was like doing a film in 1969. Like, no cell phones, doing it on film. I mean, the seriousness of it was like a throwback to the way people used to make
movies. At the end of the day, did everyone run to where their cell phone
was? No.
Funny enough, not really. Like, people got into the real swing of it, right?
He wants that focus. Everyone's kind of incredibly excited to be working on a Tarantino movie. The guy's a badass. you just feel this palpable energy that all the actors, the entire crew, is at the top of their game, focused and there to do their job. And it's quite energizing. There's an electricity in the air. So.
Tell me about the day that energy, everything just worked out exactly right. And you just felt like when you were just talking. Every day.
I'd say my scene with Miss Butters. We got to do that scene together. It was pretty amazing.
Tell me what, I know, and Julia knows us. I started camp, and literally the first thing I treated was like, Sony needs to start an Oscar campaign for Julia Butters.
Does everyone else do a deep dive on sort of that time period and the Manson killings and so on and so forth? Or do you not need to do it because it wasn't what happened? Does that make sense?
I mean, I'm a Los Angeles native. My parents are still hippies, so I grew up with the sort of Manson story. But what was fascinating about Tarantino's approach on this, and in reference to what he did in Boris Babbitt. so singularly a part of Quentin Tarantino's mind that he would take you off on this sort of red herring and lead up to this, and then all of a sudden have this strange sort of cathartic redemption, which was, in a weird way for me, was like his redemption of that time period, the age of, you know, great cinema and the culture changing and everything changing in America. It was like this homage to what could have been in the town that he grew up in and loved.
I see it that way. There's a real inherent sweetness to Quentin that you don't see necessarily in films or when he's excited talking about films. But there's a real inherent sweetness in it. And, you know, I just see this kid who was growing up with films, television, probably spent a lot of time alone. And it became his. No, but I mean, I'm really kind of moved by this, that it became his, like his direction. He found his values through that. And there is, as a fact, what I'm saying is there's a really sweet side to him. And I get moved by the ending because it is precisely that. Wouldn't that be nice if we live in that world where those kind of things don't happen, you know, that it's vanquished and the good guys win. And it comes from a really sincere place from him, and I'm moved by it. I get moved when I see them, the camera pulls out, and everyone's okay.
What was it like shooting that last scene?
I mean, you're ridiculous. I did go, really? And he goes, it's the Madsons. But I didn't question it beyond that.
Came out with a flamethrower.
Yeah.
How real was it?
It's like, oh, that was a real flamethrower. And the first day I used that, it was a really hard day because they had created this sort of channel. By the way, all the greatest stuntmen in this town's history showed up for that. It was amazing. Yeah. And I really had to blast them with a real flamethrower and like torch all of them. And I started feeling very bad for them, but soon felt very bad for myself because that heat just wafted right back into my face, and then I had started to get chronic headaches that day, so I knew the flamethrower thing was coming back up again. But it was in the open air, thank God, and I didn't have to have the same.
So I did have a laugh when I saw it on the call sheet. It's an LDC flamethrower rehearsal.
And who lined with sauerkraut? Who said sauerkraut?
Oh, that was a good
awesome. Well, thank you guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.